Hello. There's so much to talk about, not enough time. Okay, Yad Vashem is first and foremost a memorial site that began with the Names Project, what's known today as the Pages of Testimony database, which is online. Our focus in Yad Vashem, therefore, is on the victims of the Holocaust. This has made the artifacts collection that I work with, it's made it a very personal collection. In many ways, the artifacts are a means to the story behind the artifacts. Provenance research for us, therefore, is largely, where did it come from? What can it tell us about the life and home of its original owner and of his fate during the Holocaust? This is certainly true for much of our collection. Most items have been donated by the survivors themselves or the families of the victims. Many of these are everyday items that have taken on a significance because of the events or because they were the sole remnant of a home that is no more. Most are humble artifacts, or perhaps we should say humbling, but they are a significant window through which we can view the events of the Holocaust. As noted in the project overview of the conference, the looting and destruction of Jewish cultural assets was an integral part of the Nazi political agenda to eliminate Jewish life and culture, not only the physical presence of the Jews. With this in mind, I would like to concentrate on items from the Jewish home. These have a deep significance for the Jewish household, and in view of the Nazi agenda, their survival is particularly valuable and compelling. A home is far more than a place that houses a person or persons. For each of us, it is a sanctuary, somewhere where we relax, a place we can return to after our forays into the world. As anybody who has experienced a robbery in their home will tell you, there is a feeling of violation. With this in mind, examining aspects of the plunder of homes offers a window through which we can view what has rightly been called the breakdown of civilization during the Holocaust. In the words of a German Jewish housewife who was facing the prospect of having to leave her home in May 1934, in the early days of the Nazi regime, leaving the home is much more than external change. Discarding belongings that follows this decision breaks one's thought process and one's emotions, the kernel of one's life around which your outer existence is woven. The Jewish woman, who is busy with the everyday demands of the home, encounters a vacuum. Many Jewish ceremonial objects that were taken from Jewish homes during the Holocaust found their way into the artifacts collection of Yad Vashem in various different ways. And I will relate to three different sources. One is a collection of clearly plundered artifacts that came to Yad Vashem in the 1950s through the JCR, Jewish Cultural Reconstruction. The second category is a Passover Haggadah that was taken from a Jewish home in Krakow by a German soldier. And the third is Passover dinner plates that were brought to us by the grandson of a survivor from France. The nature of research of a large collection is that one learns a lot about a broad range of subjects. And each of the above categories present different research challenges and tell completely different stories. But I hope I can share with you some of what I've learned. Due to the short framework of the talk, I will relate only briefly to the first two categories, and I will present the third case study in full. So, the JCR collection. In 1956, Yad Vashem received approximately 100 items of plundered Judaica, retrieved by the Allies and documented by the Jewish Cultural Reconstruction Organization. Many have JCR tags, but sadly, there is no catalog number on the tags. These items are an example of a collection of clearly plundered ceremonial artifacts. Most are items used in the synagogue, but some are home-related, such as spice boxes, candlesticks, Hanukkah menorahs, and some textiles. But what can we say about them in terms of provenance? Very little, in fact, except where the silver items were crafted, which varies and is not city or country specific. All the items have been photographed and cataloged on our database, but I'm the first to say that there is still much work to do. Having been engaged in the personal histories of survivors while they are still with us, these artifacts have not been a priority. But I do hope that soon we will be able to do what our colleagues in the Israel Museum have done and put this photographic catalog that we do have on our website. Second category is Passover Haggadah. This Haggadah that is attractive in its own right, bound in olive wood with an illustration of a Holy Land landmark painted on its cover and two more engraved on silver medallions embedded in the wood. It's typical of souvenirs of the land of Israel that residents of pre-state Israel in the Ottoman and British Mandate periods sent to their relatives in Europe. These items, like many others in the collection, of all sorts, not necessarily Judaica, have come to Yad Vashem from individual Germans who have come into possession of the items in various ways. What is common to these items is the sentiments expressed by the donors, a desire to return the items to the Jewish people. The Haggadah, this Haggadah specifically, was taken by a German soldier stationed in Krakow during the initial stages of the occupation, who appears to have viewed it for its cultural value, writing of its relevance to Jewish tradition in a typed document that came to us with the Haggadah. His note relating to the Haggadah, as well as the handwritten inscription on the inside cover, enabled us to track down the surviving relatives of the recipient of the Haggadah, who was murdered with his family during the Holocaust. I'm sorry, I won't go into that in detail. Okay, brings us to our third category. Third category are things that have come to us from survivors, and this is something which came to us relatively recently. This is the case study I would like to present in detail. When we were approached to pick up these items from a resident of Israel, we were somewhat skeptical of some of the details of the story. In some sense, it has raised more questions than it has answered, but it does tell a wider story, as well as its personal story. And both stories bring us face to face with the impossible reality of survival in Nazi-occupied France. It also brings home to us the value of researching just one small artifact that tells a huge story that has somehow been hidden from the public view. We were approached by a young man who had immigrated to Israel from France and whose father had come recently to retire in Israel. He related that he had in his possession Pesach plates that his grandfather, Albert Abraham Samuel, took from an abandoned Jewish house in Paris, in his words, a Rothschild home. Additionally, he said that his grandfather, who was detained in Drancy, was one of a group of workers who went out to homes that were empty of their inhabitants to clear them out. We were surprised, dubious, but curious. Receiving stories third hand is always a difficulty. But my experience has taught me that for the most part, there is a grain of truth, at least, in the story. Getting to it, though, involves research to see what or how it is true. And the background upon which the events occurred is far from normal circumstances. So we approach the story with a degree of skepticism, but at the same time, keeping ourselves open to what we could learn. First, let me present the artifacts as artifacts themselves. They're not traditional Passover Seder plates that are common for the centerpieces of the Passover Seder, but rather they appear to be a set of dinner plates of assorted colors. We received a black and a green. There's also a red that the family retained. And because of the short time, I will show you just one medallion close up. In the center of each plate in Hebrew is the word matzah. But surrounding it is a decorated border of 7 medallions depicting scenes copied from illustrations that are known from the Amsterdam Haggadah. The medallions depict scenes related to the Exodus, which is the story told at the Seder. And here we have the scene of the 4 sons, which is a major part of the Seder. And at the top, of course, you can see the medallion on the plate. And in the corner, the scene as it is in the Amsterdam Haggadah, quite clearly one relates to the other. We learned that similar decorative plates were first made in the 1920s in England by order of the merchant Solomon Bardiger, an immigrant to the UK from the Ukraine, who asked Ridgeway Potteries in England to make this plate. Mr. Bardiger apparently ran a china shop in East London on Brick Lane, which is the heart of Jewish London. His china shop was known for its special plates and crockery sets for Passover. Apparently, these plates were so popular that the inscriptions that we saw before, as you see in French, les filles sages, were translated into French, and they were produced for the French market, Jewish market, by Tepper of Paris. What was more difficult for us to ascertain is how they came into the possession of Albert Samuel, who, as you remember, we were told, would go out to homes with work details that were emptying homes. So our questions were, what exactly was Albert Samuel's fate during the war, and how did he survive? Second, in what circumstances would or could a Jew have access to property from a Jewish home? And our third question was Rothschild. Is this meant literally a Rothschild home? We thought that any Rothschild property was expropriated upon the arrival of the Nazis in Paris. But our first source was the grandson, Laurent Samuel. He was the one that actually gave us the plates. He said that his father, Michel, who was born in 1932, told him the story. He had the story. Michel's parents were Albert Avram Samuel, and his mother was Esther Pinto. Michel has a brother, Maurice Samuel, also born in 1937. Albert, of course, is no longer alive, but Michel, when we requested, gave a testimony in French. He was a boy of 10 in 1942, but he gave testimony of what he knew. He says that Albert was a butcher by profession who worked in his father-in-law's butcher shop in Paris. In the big roundup of July 1942, Albert was arrested by French police and sent to Drancy, where he presented himself upon registration as a cook. From his son's testimony, we understand he was able to see his father from time to time because Albert was allowed to leave the camp to procure items necessary for food preparation. Michel says quite clearly that Albert was released from Drancy on condition that he work for the Germans. Among other things, he states that his father would go out to a garage of the Germans. We weren't sure what he meant by garage. But we were able to find documentation from the Mémorial de la Shoah in Paris. And here we learn that Albert was born in Turkey. He had Turkish nationality. He was married to a Jewish woman, and they had 2 children that we know of, Michel and Maurice. And what was most interesting, which is very difficult to see on the slide, is what is written in pencil at the bottom, was that he was released on the 3rd or the 8th of December, 1942. It wasn't quite clear. So this gives us from July to December is 6 months, perhaps. The other document we received, which is even poorer quality, has more or less the same information. But again, what is interesting and what is most important is what is written, handwritten at the bottom. It says in French, ne pas inquiéter Ujif, do not worry, Ujif, and an indication that there is something written on the back of the card. And on the back, what it says, translated into English, is permit confirmed March 1943. We understand that that Albert was released in December 1942, but obviously has some kind of legitimization in March 1943. We understand that Albert certainly worked in the Ujif Jewish organization, but who are they? The organization was set up by the Vichy France government under pressure from the Nazis to extend social services to the Jews. This replaced already existing organizations. The Nazi aim was to better control the Jewish population, while the Vichy leaders, as anti-Semites in their own right, appear to have been focused on getting their hands on Jewish assets. In any case, certainly in Paris and the occupied zone, as time went on, French influence dwindled, Nazi control increased, and the fine line between necessary cooperation and outright collaboration is a subject that much has been written about. The Ujif organization and its Jewish leadership were very late in realizing that their position was actually untenable and that their role was growing similar to the role of the Judenrats in Poland. But it is necessary to put this into context because the situation in France is far more complicated than the situation in countries where there was total capitulation to the Nazi occupiers. A number of different factors contributed to the unique situation in France under Nazi occupation. First and foremost was the establishment of the Vichy government, who collaborated with Nazi policy regarding the persecution of the Jews, and on occasion acted independently to enact anti-Semitic legislation. By passing laws on the roundup of immigrant French Jews, they also exacerbated already existing internal divisions in the Jewish community itself between long-standing French citizens and recent Jewish immigrants. It's almost impossible for us to understand the situation of those leaders of French Jewry who were trying to continue to provide welfare to an increasingly impoverished community in the occupied zone with fewer and fewer resources. By the time they realized what their predicament was, they themselves became targets of the Nazi regime. Regarding the subject of the plunder of Jewish homes, I had little knowledge of this chapter of the plunder of Paris, and I am indebted to a number of researchers who have published on this subject in recent years, notably Sara Gensberger and Jean-Marc Dreyfus. Now, we all know quite a bit about the plunder undertaken by the Nazis under Rosenberg and the ERR. This is particularly regarding the plunder of art. But learning more of the details of the looting in Paris has indeed convinced me of what Dreyfus and Gensberger have termed succinctly, that Nazism was in part an immense looting project. After Operation Barbarossa in the summer of 1942, the project begun by Rosenberg grew to enormous proportions, and under his deputy Kurt von Baer, as far as Jewish property was concerned, the situation changed from economic Aryanization to complete dispossession. Excuse me. November 1941 was a month of important changes, and a new legal framework was put into effect on the subject of orchestrated plunder, certainly by the Nazis, but with active cooperation by Vichy French officials. A Nazi law came into effect on November 25, 1941, stating that all Jewish property was now property of the Reich. And a few days later, interestingly enough, a French law was passed setting up the Ujif as the representative organization of French Jewry. A month later, in December 1941, a decision was made to set up what became known as Mobile Action, or Operation Furniture. Rosenberg then became Minister of Eastern Territories, and his deputy, Kurt von Baer, was under him as head of Operation Furniture. Kurt von Baer, a native of Hanover, who had been imprisoned in France during World War I and lived there for a number of years, proceeded to set up offices in Paris, as well as Belgium and Holland, in which he placed experts in assorted fields for the purpose of appraising plundered items. It was at this point that what appears to have been taking place since the occupation of Paris became even more organized, and I learned that in March 1942, there were three work camps or depots set up in Paris. The three took the name of Levitan, which was housed on Rue de Faubourg, Rue de Faubourg-Saint-Martin, and it was also called Camp Ost because it was close to the Gare de l'Est, the railway station. There was Austerlitz, which was next to Austerlitz station, and Bassano, which was on Bassano Street, and it was in the former home of the Jewish banker Kahn d'Anvers that was expropriated early in the occupation. Now, I'd like to show you something about Levitan, which, of course, was a Jewish department store before the war. And this is their publication from before the war. It was a very large department store, as he terms it the most beautiful store in the world. But then I want to show you the next picture. You can be forgiven for thinking that this is a photo that was used for the brochure. Actually, this was from an album stored in the Koblenz archive. The album itself was put together by historians or archivists working under the Allies in 1948, but the photos were taken during the war, presumably staged by the Nazis. They effectively document the work of the ERR in Paris. Many of the photos were taken in Levitan, which as a former department store was well set up as a place where one could display assorted wares. This album was published by Sarah Gensberger in French in 2010 and translated to English in 2015. It's called Witnessing the Robbing of the Jews. I recommend you take a look at it. For more than 2 years, trucks went back and forth through the streets of Paris on their way to pick up objects looted from Jewish apartments. Both the drivers and the removal teams were French, as were the removal vans. The economic situation being as it was in occupied Paris, this was most likely a large part of their workload. Already in May 1941, the Nazi authorities had already set up the Organizational Committee for Removal and Storage Businesses to serve as an intermediary between these companies and Von Baer's Dienste der Westen. So how did it work? The keys for the apartments were held by the concierge of the building, who was supposed to pass the keys on to the French government representatives, or the keys would be obtained from the police. An initial team of Dienststelle employees would inventory the apartment's contents and seal the apartment while transport was organized. In the case of a Jewish apartment, it would be thoroughly looted from the largest furniture to the smallest objects. I will show a few photos of these. The workforce in the depots, Levitan, Austerlitz, and Bassano, consisted of prisoners from Drancy, apparently from among those who were non-deportable, those who were termed by the Nazis as Mischlinge, or those perhaps with foreign citizenship. As you remember, Albert was Turkish citizen. You can see he has an armband on his arm, and he's sorting through all sorts of artifacts. Here you see just piles and piles of artifacts that have been sorted according to type. Pots and pans. We're not talking valuable artwork here. Textiles. This, if you can see, there's a doll upside down in the box. The woman has an armband. And Sara Gensberger was able to go through the photographs and identify many of them being from Levitan because of furniture or handrails in the background of the photo. Here we have shoes. Well, okay, so back to officially, let me just go back one second. One thing I did want to say. Who were the beneficiaries of these goods? Officially, the goods recovered in Paris, Belgium, and the Netherlands were slated to furnish the homes of German colonists who would settle in the conquered territories, as well as the German authorities themselves. But effectively, anyone who was bombed out could apply, and the closer one was to the powers that be, the better his access. According to testimonies of the survivors of these camps, von Baer himself and his wife in particular went shopping in these centers. And certainly Vichy French officials could also shop in these depots. So to return to our plates, many details are still unclear, but the story given by Albert Samuel's descendants now seem more plausible. As you see, I was hoping to have a photo of Albert for the lecture, but it still hasn't arrived. And I can see I put myself, I was obviously very confident it would come before the lecture. Okay. Albert was rounded up in July 1942 and officially released from Drancy in December 1942. To quote his son, as I said, on condition he worked for the Nazis. Michel relates that having seen the transports going out from Drancy to the east, his father was terrified. Twice there are notes on Albert's documentation relating to the UGIF, one from March 1943. And this is interesting in light of what is known of the known pressure on the UGIF in March 1943 to relinquish its protection of 50% of its employees who were from among the recent immigrant Jewish population in France. It appears that Albert was among the lucky few who received this legitimization. The details regarding Albert's forced labor are still not clear, and we have found no evidence yet that Jews served as members of the work details. But it seems to me that it is certainly plausible that during this time, he was somehow employed in the service of the apparatus that was carefully looting Jewish homes of everything, from stoves to books to ashtrays. Michel himself, Albert's son, was sent with his brother into hiding sometime in 1943. So his testimony is not firsthand. But he stresses that his father was detained for 16 months in total, which would take us until October 1943. During this time, Michel states that his father would go out to a garage, as I said. I had thought that garage, perhaps, garage, though I know is generally a place for cars, I thought perhaps it could also be a depot like those we've seen in the photos. But on speaking to him again, I understand that it was definitely a garage for cars, but that every day his father would be sent out with a group of manual laborers to different places, and one of these places, he insists, is a Rothschild home, and that he put the plates under his shirt and smuggled them out. But I had wondered about the Rothschild home. Again, I had thought it had been anything of Rothschild's would have been expropriated with Rosenberg's onslaught on Paris, along with the property and assets of the other Jewish banking families. But in the circumstances, again, anything seems to have been possible. I had wondered that perhaps the reference would be to the camp on Rue Bassano, which was housed in a home formerly belonging to the banker Kahn d'Anvers, but it was owned at the time of the war by a descendant of his, the wife of Gustave de Rothschild in England. So we're back to a Seder table, which is what we had on the right, which I showed in the first photo. And seeing as we're talking of Seder, of Passover plates, I've juxtaposed it next to a photograph from the Koblenz album, which is chilling. But what this story brings home to me is just how fragile our existence is. I look at the situation in the 4 years of Nazi occupation and French collaboration, and I'm chilled by the organized, legislated, relatively swift breakdown of civilization in the country whose motto is equality, fraternity, and liberty. It's difficult, or perhaps it's all too simple for us to look back from 2018 and living in an ordered world to try to understand the reality of then. But as Primo Levi admonished in his introduction to the book, If This Is a Man, you who live safe in your warm houses, you who find warm food and friendly faces when you return home, never forget that this has happened. Remember these words, engrave them in your hearts, when at home or in the street, when lying down, when getting up. Repeat them to your children. Thank you.